Okay, so I'm down in Temecula at Aqua Ultraviolet, and in the previous video, you saw me installing the quartz sleeve onto that Viper unit, and you saw it crack. I'll show a replay of it for you right now.
So now, we are perfectly lined up on both sides. You've got to be freaking kidding me. I don't know what happened. You really just saw that happen. I have absolutely no idea what went wrong here.
It was shocking to me, but I'm pretty certain I figured out what the problem is, and it was the white part at the end. I'll show it to you. Hang on. Look at it. It's really hard for the camera to pick it up, but if you notice, there's a little bit of a gap right there at the top, okay? And as I turn it and rotate it over, you see that gap's not there. You see that? I know you do, because I can see it. And so what I think happened is that, and I'm going to put this gap up here at the top, and if you look carefully, if you look really closely, you'll see it's kind of bent down just a little tiny bit. And I think that that was just enough to be able to apply pressure against that quartz sleeve to cause it to crack. So in this video, I'm going to go ahead and reinstall it. I'm also going to show you one other really valuable tip with these units. But I will say, excellent customer service from these guys. Not only did they take my unit and find the problem and put a brand new quartz sleeve in there for me, but we also addressed the flow control switches. And so that's one of the things I'm going to show you. So I'm going to tell you guys, these guys are awesome. So if you have a concrete pond, I'm a water garden guy. All I install is aquascape ecosystem ponds. I'm a firm believer in the ecosystem. But every now and then we come across customers that have the concrete ponds, and I'm a firm believer in their means of filtration for concrete ponds. You just cannot beat them. All's well that ends well. I'm going to go ahead and take this unit. I'm going to reinstall it for you. I'm going to show you a few tips and tricks in the end of this video. And so stay tuned, hang in there with me, and I will show you exactly what's going on. I'm at the property now where we need to replace this Viper unit, and I'll show you the pump and filter setup that's out here. And I'm going to kind of walk you through what he has in terms of pumps, filtration, and then I'm going to walk you up and show you the pond. This area over here is what we would refer to as our backwash pit. This thing was backwashed the other day, but what we have here is we have a series of pipes here that are going down into the ground that's infusing this backwash water right here, keeping the water right here onto the property. But over here is where he has all of his pumps and filtration set up. This is where the Viper unit goes, and we have two Performance Pearl pumps running, and we have two Ultima 2 20,000 filters over here. The reason why we have these types of filters, now we did not install these guys, we came across this property, but the reason why they have them is for ease of backwashing. Personally, if it was me, I would much rather replace these guys and use wetland filtration all the way. So we're going to repair and replace the Viper unit here, and when I'm done with that, we'll go ahead and put these pump covers here back in place over the top of the pumps. This is an aerator, and this aerator is blowing air all the way up and over to the pond, which is on the other side of the hill over here. Let me walk you over there. And here's our pond. We have excellent plant life throughout this pond. Beautiful lily pads are just growing. It's just amazing. But we still have a tremendous problem here with green water. And I know, I just know without a shadow of doubt, if we were to install wetland filtration, it would completely clear this area up. This one over here is old. It was built, I believe, by his dad, and his parents have owned this property for a very, very long time. This is a family heirloom property, and the property owner here, he's an amazing customer of ours, really great guy. I'm hoping to run into him today. He knows I'm out here today, so we'll see. So I'm gonna go ahead and get the Viper unit hooked back up and show you a few more tips and tricks on this before this video is over. So I've already hand tightened down our couplers over here, these half unions, and now we have our flow control switch. Now this flow control switch, it's very simple the way that it works. Water pressure hits it and it turns it on. Water pressure isn't enough, turns it off. Just a very simple switch. If you ever take apart one of these pieces here, be sure to go ahead and peel off the old Teflon tape. And this is one of those parts here, you've seen me throughout this video saying don't Teflon, but this right here is something you absolutely definitely want to do. Okay, we do have a problem. On the right hand side is the old flow control switch, and on the left hand side is the new one. Lining them up with each other, you can absolutely see that the shaft is longer on the flow control on the right than it is on the left. So that has to be replaced. I'm going to put a brand new flow control on here. And the reason that that creates a problem is that if there's ever any debris inside the pipe, then that's going to stick that switch into the on position. It's going to melt this UV. The body cracked and water was spraying all over the place. When you look on the inside of it, you've got this flow control switch here. See if I can get it in the sun nice enough. I'm just showing you pictures of what it looks like on the inside. But what's crazy is if you look at the other side of it here, you can see this just totally burned out right over here at the top. You see that? It's just like completely smoked. I suppose a really easy hack would be to just cut the tip of that off, but Aqua Ultraviolet doesn't want us to do that. We're going to go ahead and replace this flow control with a new one here. So these guys really just want to be hand tightened. Again, we've got some Teflon on this fitting here, but it's important when you put these on that you read the label. If you look at the label over here, there is an arrow pointing in the direction of the flow. So you've got the water coming in, going across the flow switch, and going through the UV and going back out. The only part we have left is to make our connections. So we're gonna go into the transformer box. We're gonna unscrew this, and we're going to replace that cable coming into the bottom, and we will be good to go. So this is the inside of the transformer for the Viper. And it's very simple. We just have a couple of really basic connections here. We want to disconnect the black and the white just simply by unplugging these guys. Then we'll unscrew this connection here from the bottom of the box, run a brand new cable here into the bottom, and plug these guys back into each other. Super easy stuff. It's just really important that you make sure that you've got your power disconnected before you do this. And in our particular case here, just running the length of the cord, boom, we're disconnected. So this guy is going to come apart really easy. What I'm going to do first is unscrew what's called the Davis coupler right over here. This basically just puts a little bit of pressure on the cord so the cord can't be pulled out. So as you see, as I'm pushing up and down, once this cap is screwed into place here, that doesn't happen anymore, okay? You also might notice this little green light. When the flow switch is activated, then that turns on the power to the ballast, and the ballast right here turns on the power to the bulb. So we have just a few things we gotta do here. First things first, I wanna just disconnect this guy here and get this out of here. One thing I wanna point out is when you pull these apart, do not pull on the wire itself, pull from the coupler here. It's not going to take a whole lot to rip these guys here out, even if they're soldered and crimped down good and tight. So just as a means of good practice, pull them out from here and from here, not from the wires themselves. This little guy here, he's going to unscrew. There, he's off, and now the entire cable can now be pulled out from underneath. It's really that simple, not hard at all. So the last thing we need to do here is replace the bulb. When you get a new bulb, it's going to come in a really nice sealed plastic pouch like this. It's absolutely critical that you do not touch this bulb under any circumstances at all whatsoever. So handle it only by the wires, and I'm going to show you how we line them up inside this UV here and how we tighten it down. It's really super simple. Before you insert your bulb into the quartz sleeve, make sure that if during shipment these little washers here have fallen off and they moved out of place, be sure to get them right over here like you see over here next to my fingers. So after I plug in the bulb, you'll see that I kind of like to have them just kind of like leveling off right at about here as an equal distance. You want to look inside your quartz sleeve just to make sure that the bulb is as centered in the middle of the unit as we possibly can. And then all we have to do at that point is put the cap on the end of this, tighten it down with the Davis coupler right over here, and away we go. You'll know your bulb is perfectly centered, and if you look inside and you see how that washer there is kind of blocking out the part of the UV where the flow is. So that washer is probably right at about here, okay? And the flow is coming through the center of the UV right about in here someplace, okay? So the idea is to transmit that ultraviolet light to the center here where the water is flowing through, okay? Not allow it to refract out. You see this little grommet right over here? That's what allows this cap here to tighten down and to keep the cord from moving. So once you have everything in place, then just go ahead and tighten this guy down, and look at this, the cord doesn't move at all. This is not a watertight cap, by the way. This is watertight here. I'm noticing that there's a little tiny crack right over here. We'll still replace that, but this here, this is where your watertight is. What we don't want to do is we don't want to let any rain to get inside here. Fortunately, we're in Southern California where it doesn't rain a whole lot. So we've got this. We're just going to kind of put him in there. Now, one last thing. We're in a flooded application. Our pond water level is up here. So all of our return lines and so on and so forth are below water level of the pond over here. So we've got our pump coming up over here, and we have our UV, but this is still considered an incorrect installation of this UV. We did not install this. We're going to have to come back, and we're going to have to make one more correction to it, and that's that we need to bring this UV unit here. We need to cut this pipe, lower it down, and then have it come over and down and then over across and then elbow back up and come back over. So we're going to come back and we're going to do that on another day. But for right now, we're going to be able to get this bad boy up and running. I'm going to go ahead and fire up our pump. Looks like we just need to open up the valve. We're open and we've got our return line. Let's go ahead and open that up over here. And so now we've got water coming in, we got water coming out. And it looks like whoever last serviced this did not tighten down. The lid got some leaking going on over here, so I'm going to have to tighten that down. So one last thing you want to do before you plug anything in or hook up your bulb or anything is you want to pressure test your application. Make sure that when you turn it on that you're not going to have water. And something's wrong with the gaskets on this side over here because, watch this, that should not be happening right here. So now I got to take this thing apart and try to figure out what's going on over here. This guy here, he's seated properly all the way in here. And so is this one over here. So fortunately, I have some replacement parts. So here's what I did, is I swapped these guys around from one side to the other, and I really cranked this side here down, which seems to have stopped the leak from over at this side here. So once I turn on the power, oh, see, look, we still have a little bit of a drip. See that? Nope, that still isn't good. See if cranking that down just a little bit more helps. No. See, this is no good. You can't have this. You can't have, this has to be completely dry on the inside. So something is terribly wrong inside this unit here. But now we got another problem. The inside of this quart sleeve is loaded up with water. So now I have to find a way to get the water out of this because this is completely unacceptable. So, fortunately, I have in my truck a long sleeve shirt, and I happen to have some yard flags. So, I'll show you what I'm going to do. So, I'm taking this yard flag, and I'm using it to push my long sleeve shirt. It's a very thin fabric through the center of it, so that I can dry out the inside and the outside of this quart sleeve. So just got to give it a little bit more of a shove so I can pull that end of that out and dry that thing off. So now that I'm able to pull that through, I can kind of give it a really good dry it off on the outside and on the inside, and we'll try it again and see what's going on. But I'm also looking here at the inside of this guy here, and he looks like he's got some score marks. So I'm going to go ahead and replace him. Maybe that's what it is. If you look inside here, I don't know how well my focus is on this. I'm sorry for the focus. But if you look in right there, you'll see some score marks. You might see some. Anyways, the camera's not picking it up very well, but you might see them. They're at the very bottom of this bushing here. So I'm going to replace this bushing, and I'm just kind of hoping that these score marks here might be our culprit. Sorry about the focus. Back up to the filter. Okay, so with the original cap back in place on both sides, the replacement cap over here, with a new quart sleeve, everything's loaded in. Now it's time for us to test fire this yet once again. Here we go. And now we have no drips. None whatsoever. We're in really good shape. So here's the thing, you got to be patient. You got to keep a level head when you're working with these things. You got to think your way through it. We're still not done because I still have to hook up the bulb. I have to dry off the bulb because it was wet, and I've got to make sure that this thing is completely dried off, and I got to hook it up, and I got to dry off all my fittings and everything else before I can put this thing back together again. because if I have any moisture in there at all, it's going to short this thing out in a second. No questions asked. So with our system turned on, you can clearly see that the light is glowing inside there. See that purplish light, like right in this corner right over here. So our light's working just fine. Our flow control switch is obviously working because power would not find its way here. And one last thing is if you look underneath here, you'll see that this little guy here is lit up. So when that guy lights up, that tells you that you have power to the UV. And of course, it's a no-brainer that you got power when you can look through the side of it and you can see that that light glowing. So the only thing that's left here now is to just go ahead and button this thing back up, put our panel back together, and clean up our mess a little bit over here. So this guy here, he's just going to slide. See those notches right there? He's going to slide right over the top of that. You're going to lift them, hold them into place, and this little screw over here, just going to go ahead and get him started and then tighten him down with a flathead. Just about everything that could have gone wrong has gone wrong here, and this is why you want to subscribe to my YouTube channel, so that you can see these things. And I, you know, a lot of these how-to videos are going to show you, oh, how easy it is and how simplistic it is, and they're going to bypass all the problems so that the person filming the video doesn't look stupid. Hey, look, I know this looks like an absolute mess, and you know what? Every possible thing that could have gone wrong, I think, has gone wrong here, and I want you to benefit from it. So everything's put back together again. Everything is humming and doing what it's supposed to be doing, so I'm done here. Couple things, just like in closing. One, I really prefer wetland filtration. All these external pumps and filters and UVs, do we know how to do them? Yes, we do. Do we want to do them? No, we don't. These things here are a pain, but in the right application, they are absolutely useful. In a concrete pond, you better believe it. In a natural ecosystem pond, I really prefer to work with nature as opposed to working against nature. And unfortunately, that's what's happening here with this water feature. We still are adding a ton of beneficial bacteria, and we're adding all sorts of other things into this water to be able to try to balance it out. And unfortunately, this weekend's Mother's Day, and now we still have stuff to do. So look, if you have a pond like this, am I advocating ultraviolet lights and bead filters and external pumps? In this pond up here that I showed you earlier, we have 40,000 gallons worth of filtration on this pond, and it still isn't enough, even with all the plant life that are supposed to be sucking the nutrient out of this pond. So I have a feeling that we're not done here. I have a feeling that we need to go in here and we need to drag the bottom of the pond, get all the sludge off the bottom. I'd be willing to bet you that there is probably feet worth of sludge on the bottom of this thing that needs to be drug out and pumped out and mitigated. So we're going to be visiting this pond quite often, and we're going to figure this thing out. And as long as you're subscribed to my YouTube channel, you're going to see it too. I'm Carl with Columbia Water Gardens, and I'm here to remind you that doing ponds right the first time matters. Happy ponding.